What a strange night, isn't it? Okay. Well, we've explored everything. Eh? Sure, I guess we can go over there. Sun rises and falls, and once again you return to the Minisks. Their unliving creation for you has begun to take shape. It is a geometric curiosity with triangles joined together in a difficult harmony, and once again they dare to request a favor from you. It takes quite a bit of time before you fully grasp what they're asking for. They need a green-orange kind of shine stone called copper. There are small amounts of it in the shiny things you might find all over the land. They will need twice the number of shiny things as they have claws, both for their own purposes and to finish your gift. We only have one? Okay, let's return later. Good thing that does not waste a day. However, 1, 2, 3 shiny spots is remaining. Can we actually sell anything to Darktooth? Forty lesser treasure. I kind of want the bloodstone. You know what? I'm gonna go get rid of the silver fruit. You know what? You're gonna find out what the silver fruit does. I know it because I've done it before, but you guys haven't seen it. But I think it's in our interest to dispose of it as fast as possible. Hello, Darktooth. How shall you address the elder? Great one, what is this? Showed Darktooth the silver fruit. Darktooth sniffs at the object and then it blinks. A shiver runs to its feathers. With a single motion, Darktooth sweeps it into its own mouth and swallows it. Before you can object, Darktooth sings soothingly. Fear not, you shall be compensated. This item is too dangerous to leave in the care of your youngling. It may summon calamity to your lands. It is... other. I will simply destroy it, but I happen to have a use for such a thing. Darktooth gives you quite a few shiny things, more than you thought the object should have been worth, which helps with a chagrin. And we have 16. Nope. I do not want to, I do not want to actually sell anything else. Now, what we're gonna be doing next now. Let's actually check if we can still do the Minisks. Nope, still not qualified for that option. Hopefully one of these should do it. This is the amber spot. Let's go here. Aha, topaz. Here, where Earth begins to rise skyward in Browning Falls, you make an interesting discovery. Several large stones are birthing glistening progeny. They burn softly with a color which reminds you of sun. Perhaps Earth longs for him and made these in her yearning. These are not metallic shinestone, but gems and will not be melted by a breath. Extracting them from the stones will take much time and care, but such shiny things as these will be highly prized by any kin. What will you do? Use the shake stick to extract the bounty. You grasp the shake stick in your maw, aim it at the boulders, and press the indentations to the foreclaw. The air pulses with ripples like the disturbed surface of a pond, silent but still rattling in your teeth. The stone grasping the treasure is broken apart in shuddering fits right before your very muzzles, releasing chunks of its precious bounty. The crystal figurines are then easily pulled out. The apricot sparkle looks even more fetching when they find their new home in your trove. Oh yes, much shine field treasure! Okay, I wonder if this is like enough for the Minisks. Give them the many shiny things they are asking for. You deliver the requested number of shiny things, certainly a noticeable reduction of your trove. It hurts you deep within to see such a things. That tiny links promise that when the next they see you, you will have your prize. Okay, we are hungry. Okay, we still have time. Okay, let's see. You have 50% of the clan singer stat. Okay, you know what? Let's go eat something. There are several scents in the air, one familiar to this place, but a few others. Which will you follow? A large fur beast with a predator scent. Ah. Your keen senses have revealed the presence of a clansinger here. It makes no sign of acknowledgement. It seems not to know that you are here. Its body and yours are nowhere near to each other. The wind is not in your favor and carries your scent directly to your prey. You must move quickly if you wish to sneak up on it. Let us observe it as much as possible. With the bonus from the Brightling Dragon, it shouldn't take too much to... Oh, it notices you and turns to attack. Begin the dance of destruction. What's his stats like? Fire, air, fire, water. Okay, let's go brace. Let's hope that we don't get killed. Brace! Okay, we mastered it. Okay, so air, its next attack will be fire. Pacify! And then the next will be okay, so air, for he attacked with air, then fire, then water next. Let's blow it away literally with wind. Swift strike! And then the next attack will be water, so we're gonna be using... Not water. The next attack will be fire, so we're gonna use... We're gonna extinguish the fire with a flowing strike. Ah! Oh wait, mistake? It used air instead. Okay, we'll use water next. That's fine. While not particularly sweet or savory, the singer's flesh burns pleasantly in your core. You feel strengthened and invigorating after consuming such a noble good beast. Poor doggy. You have gained a lot of energy, and you've learned more about the way of the clan singers. And that's a heal, nice. A moderately sized fur beast with a delicious scent. Let's try that. Ah. The taste of wood strider essence is upon the air. It makes no sign of acknowledgement. It seems not to know that you're here. Oh, interesting that I got you feel strengthened, which is a stat bonus. Let us silently draw nearer. We actually mastered this. Let us observe. Keep observing until we get noticed. It notices you and flees. Okay, almost there. Chase after it. Thankfully, we are quick. And I'm gonna go throw that. Okay, not too much, stats for this, hatchling. So we're just gonna go brace it until we, get the mastery. The woodstrider hatchling's calls for aid are answered. It got replaced by an actual full-grown woodstrider. Interesting. Okay, let's go nerf this with pacify. What was his last attack? Oh, that's a bad idea. Okay, so it's earth. The next is gonna be water. So we're gonna go use a swift strike. Okay, so it used water. It's gonna use fire next, so we're gonna use flowing strike. No? Air? Maybe I misread that. Okay, it's gonna use earth next, so bite is fine. Actually, you know what? Let's go use swift strike. There we go. What once the leaves of the great trees was fashioned into the body and essence of this graceful woodstrider, and now it is yours. The meal leaves you feeling deeply satisfied. Oof. You have gained a lot of energy. Okay. We shouldn't actually eat too much. The soft overcomes the hard, water dissolves even great mountains in time. The path to true mastery lies not in strength nor domination, but through knowing. Knowing the caress of leaf upon soft land, knowing the cool clear stream flowing without and within, knowing the bright and quiet places hidden from the eye. We have become one with the great green, and the crown is given unto us for the head, for the soul. We are lovers. This is our way, the good way of the wooden striders. The ambassador way of the wooden striders in the one with the elements has grown. We are the people of the far-telling song, who sing our great secret to those who would hear. To be alone is to be weak, to be together is strength. Our love for each other is our true fur, our true fang. Only with others can one hunt great prey, and the greatest of prey is the knowledge of self. We are all pups of the great dead mother, drinking her milk we grow strong, her milk streaming bright across the night sky. This is our way, the good way of the clan singers. You have mastered the way of the clan singers, and your bond with the elements has grown. Nice. I wonder if we have time before Bloom shows up. Are you satisfied and your song of life continues? You know what? Let's do the wolf plotline. When exploring your lands, you have come across a young warrior of the Clansinger people. It is alone and unlike most of its kind, when it senses you, it does not sing together its clan. Its body language is cautious yet respectful. It seems to be leaving its homelands, though you have heard that the Clansinger value their lands and family above all. What will you do? Let's communicate. You wordlessly hail a good beast with a plane and hit an approach. It stops, waiting for you to draw near. There is only a tiny hint of fear in its scent. I am Six Dota Bows. What the business has one of the ancient kin with a lone clan singer? What will you do? Ask after the clan singer people, what are their ways and truths? The clan singers are proud children of the earth and sun. We have knowledge of a great truth. Many can become one. We join together to hunt greater prey, as all know. Even the great grazers are not safe from us when we see with many eyes, hear with many ears, and strike with many fangs. When we succeed, we celebrate with crystal pure song and sleep drunk with warm flesh. But the truth of the many and one goes beyond this. We can form bonds with each other in which a new essence is created, the spirit of the clan. Each clan has a different spirit, bound by love and defined by the wisdom of its members. From birth, we are taught not only to survive, but to love our clan, to love our prey, to love rich earth and clear night with the scent of our creators. Our people are found all over their great mother's body, and our song echoes from every green. More proof that we are beloved of earth can never be given. Ask the clan singer why it's leaving the lands of its people. I am loved by my wise birth creator and my bold giver creator, and safe in the embrace of my clan. This land is rich and good. Few indeed would leave such wealth. However, it is the way of the clan series that only the worthy may do the dance of the creation. Only the mightiest birther and the mightiest giver may join together to make the future. In this way, we pass down strength to those who come after us. The noble desire to create has arisen within me as I am related to the rest of the clan. I must seek out a stranger whose heart I will hunt and who will hunt mine. And we shall become one, forging a new clan and bringing the song of my people to new lands. Most are content to live and die in their birth clan, but to bravely enter the unknown is the price one must pay if one wishes to pass on their essence. I will create or I will perish, so I have sworn and sundered the bonds of my birth clan. I am cold and alone now, but I have chosen this path and will walk it with sure paws and clear eyes. As a clan singer, when he has knowledge of any treasure. Yeah, I should really be careful of the honor scroll, because I could accidentally attack it. Indeed, I know of many treasures. My creators, splits a night and fragrant spirit are treasures to me. My clanmates, each of them, I treasure in my heart and will never forget. The hill then where I was born is a treasure. The prey I have consumed were all treasures, and this land is a treasure. I hold them all within me, and they can never be lost or taken. It is sung that a kin seeks strange treasures, things which cannot show love and which can be stolen away, and yet are somehow valuable. If you seek such things, great kin, I know of none. As the clan singer waits, people sing to the moon. We do not sing to the moon, that is a false truth. We sing upwards so that the sound goes out along the air paths, traveling far before it falls back to blessed earth and other ears. And we sing on the bright moon-drenched nights, for that is when it's easiest to hunt and the land is its most beautiful. Our praise, though, is not to the moon, but to our honorable prey who has given its life so that we may live, and to our clan, and to Earth, the great mother of us all. And now we dismiss it from your presence. May you learn, live in love, great kin, if love your people can know. It continues on its way with the easy loping gait of a long-distance traveler. You never see it, nor smell it again. Okay. You have found the lair of the clan singers deep in the heart of the Packlands. Most of the clan is out hunting this day, but they have boasted a sentry. Its posture and energy leave absolutely no room for doubt. It is guarding some kind of treasure. Sneaking past it will be impossible as it is directly blocking the lair. How will you proceed? Yeah, you know what? The clan singers are an honorable people and so are we. After you step out of hiding and announce your challenge, the sentry replies. I am guarding the treasure, the one left behind. I am old but strong, forged in many battles. My body and essence are unified and standing between our most prized possession and any who will take it. Though I fear you, I shall remain like a stone, unmoved and ever ready, and honor your challenge. Let the dance of destruction begin. Okay. Let's start with bite. Ooh! Okay, started off with a water attack, which is interesting. Next one will be fire, so we're gonna go reply with a flowing pacify to reduce its damage output to us. Okay, next is gonna be air, so let's go counter with power strike. Nice! The guardian is defeated and attempts to escape. Will you allow it to leave? Yes. Entering the lair, you are dismayed to find no shiny things or rare objects. Instead, you see several hatchlings of the clan seer people. They are redolent with fear, but one of them bravely stands and approaches you. I am Shining Eye, last born of the future of the Clans of the Spirit Clan. Have you come to destroy us, Great Drayek? The aroma of their delicious, tender, milk-fed flesh calls to you. Altogether, they will be a fine, very fine meal indeed, and their defenses, their small fangs and claws not even capable of piercing your armor. How will you answer the hatchling's question? I mean, I know this is like a survival plus route, but it feels wrong to eat puppies. Perhaps not, but we're with them. Again, there's like a human bias. If this was a real Dreyak, let's just say they'll become mouth stuffers. Perhaps not, converse with them. He explained to the younglings that they came here in search of treasure, not food, Shining Eye replies. Actually, you know what? That might actually fit, because we are full. We are the greatest treasure of the Closet of the Spirit Clan. We are the immortality of our people. From our birther creator's body, we draw sacred milk, and from our giver creator's mouth, we receive warm flesh. We flow from them like a river bringing their songs into the future. There can be no greater treasure, so they sing. What will you do? Let them leave and leave this place. I'm pretty sure if I take one of them alive, I'm going to piss off the clan singers. Silently, we draw from the lair of the clan singers and hasten to the green, leaving before the clan arrives. When they do, they are relieved and joyous to find a precious treasure still alive and whole. You can hear them raise a song of thanksgiving for their good fortune, the song echoing and twisting joyfully among the trees. Our future lives! Love's labor is not lost. And we got the compassion stat. Unintended, but oh well. Oh, the Minisks are here. The Minisks have prepared a prismatic welcome for you this day. Your gifts have allowed them to make great progress on their mysterious mission. Their songs of thanksgiving echo a thousand colors in your mind. Joyfully, they present you with your reward, a shining confection of oddish material. They explain that it will continuously broadcast a living song, which will somehow haunt your mind for gaps in your understanding of the one song and fill them. In all honesty, most of their explanation was too complex for you, but you gather that this will automatically build your elemental mastery daily. Perpetual Pyramid. Your support, elf, and patience with the tidylings have earned you this strange and wonderful treasure. Apparently, it oozes truth, forever whispering lost secrets into the dreaming. While asleep, you may gain mastery in the elements. The business of renewal concluded, they sing one last song of thanksgiving and then return to their minuscule labors. Let us not destroy them, because, you know, we don't want to actually, you know, be bad. Depart with your prize. We are unaffected by any wounds. You have 21 shiny objects. We should talk to Darktooth. I gotta go buy myself, not a wake leaf, the poultice, I think. Yeah. And shiny things for healing poultice. So it is given, so it is sealed. Poultice, a crushed swarm of plantlings friendly to beast flesh. Okay. Thank you. Let us leave the elder's presence. Okay, I think let us go here. Let's do the last of the wolf events. A sleepless night that sends you wandering through your domain in the still dark. A song of victory draws you on to the top of the hill. Clan singers, you can barely see their bodies in the early dawn. Moon is gone and sun has not yet been born, but you smell and hear them with great clarity and their spirits burn bright. The Gearhead Chief raises his essence-stained muzzle and sings a grinding song of warning from deep in its throat. Hear me, Scion of the Ancient Ones. We are the Claws of the Spirit Clan, many talons united in one paw. My strength and wisdom and the generosity of this plane strutter, we share a victory feast well earned. This time was not, for we are many in one and you are but one. What will you do? As if they're not afraid of a mighty Dreyak. Indeed, we are afraid. We know that you hold dread destruction in your mouth, lightly like an adult holds a cub in its jaws. You know that your claws are sharp, your fangs like unbreaking stone. That is why you shall fear us, though afraid we choose a stand with honor we see clearly in our own hearts. We are many in one, and while you are only one, if you doubt, let us dance the final dance. Asking they're not ashamed of their cowardice, using many to hunt just one. It is not that only we are many in one. It is not our numbers which grant us victory, but a unity of essence, trust, and love. We hunt as one, just as our prey lives as one, and we acknowledge their sacrifice with song. To choose to love and to trust takes more courage than to hunt great prey. You cannot know our power. Warn them that aiding each other will breed weakness. Only self-sufficiency will ensure that their people will grow stronger with time. Their brother chieftain sings. Among us, only the strong may dance, only the mighty may create. I have birthed many from this body. My burning essence lives on in my cubs, strong warriors and hunters all, who know both love and violence. Do you hunt prey many times your size as we have hunted this plains runner? How can you see proof of our strength and accuse us of weakness? Not even a great lumberer is there to threaten us. Your song dies a swift death in the face of our obvious might. Challenge them for a share of the kill. The clan singers acknowledge your challenge by backing away from the kill. It lies now directly between you and they. Both their giver chief and their brother chief's tails are raised and waving boldly back and forth. A trial by fag and claw, or a trial by song? The former, let the dance of destruction begin! Oh, this is a stupid idea. I only have one life and I know these guys are strong. As you roar forth your defiance, the clan circles you, led by the giver chief. They are smaller than you, but they have learned their forbidden art of cooperation. This will not be an easy dance. The dance of destruction begins, and holy crap, their stats are amazing. This might be a mistake. Okay, so let us brace. Okay, they start with fire. They're probably gonna be doing water next, so we're gonna go, the Swiss strike. Earth? Oh no, is this like random round? Power strike! Oh wow! Did we win? We did! The clan scatters and flees, tails held low between their legs in deference to your power. The prize is yours, and more than this, you have proven your might. You partake of the small feast, which you have won. Clan singers can defeat even great lumberers, but not a great dreyak such as yourself. You have gathered a lot of energy, and we have improved reputation. Oh, come on! You hear a sudden challenge travel to the afternoon air. Behold, a flower of earth has come. Our magnanimous patrons challenge the holders of these lands. Stand before the one who rises and prepare for vagrancy. You are certainly being summoned to defend your territory, but there is something very strange. The voice is not that of a dreyak. Greetings, Odreyek! You stand now before the fabulous, marvelous, transcendent, magnificent, rising flower of earth opening into beautiful maturity! Oh, I messed that up. I tried to make different voices alternating with each other, but I think that did not come across well to the microphone. You decide to call it Bloom. And I was kind of miffed that I got this challenger, because I was trying to do something with the clan singers. Oops. Too late. Anyway, I speak with the voice of our enlightened master. Earth has revealed to our patron's advanced mind that this land, the spiritwood, is destined to become our home. Soon the green shall be transformed into a bastion for our prophet and liege, and all who wisely worship this pure, perfect Mr. Gugu. If you are so cursed and miserably foolish as to stand in a way for perfection given flesh, state your terms in advance, but beware. Will you make a challenge of battle? All of these warriors you see are one with the master and will fight you together. Against such unity you have no hope. A challenge of the mind? All of us are one in thought. What will you oppose? One of the many will not know. You are already defeated. Depart with grace and not violence. Mar the wedding of this land to its rightful overlord. How will you respond to this invader? There's a hidden option. That sucks. I almost had the good beast followers. If you complete certain requirements with the clan singers, you can ally with them. But I do it on a different playthrough, which we'll see at some point, but not this one, apparently. That sucks. Question Bloom and its followers. Being fairly certain that Earth has not appointed this or anyone kin to speak for her, you question the assertion that Bloom is her prophet. The herald replies, "Behold, another prophecy fulfilled in our prescient Lord Xenophians. Were we not told at this very sand that the dragon of these lands will malign our master's status and question our faith? Great opening flower in our rising feeds us, protects us, and makes us new paths. How now, like Earth, a great murder it is. Some of us were slaves at the tailors, but an exalted one took us in. Some were outcasts from their tribes, doomed to destruction, but we found a light by which to see a fragrant breeze to scent. How could any not sent by a great power have done such things? Verily, our patron is all-knowing, all-hearing, all-sending, incapable of error." Call Bloom's divine perfection into question, and I'm kind of very happy that the colored checks are actually working now. Somehow unbreak itself. Anyway, let's go call Bloom's divine perfection into question. Bloom has certainly armed its sycophants with a variety of counters to any suggestion of imperfection. May revolve around placing their burden of disproof upon you, relying on the simple fact that one cannot conclusively prove the absence of anything, including even the most far-fetched assertions. They also have made a virtue out of gullibility. Normally, belief in something so bizarre as Andrea, knowing literally everything and being sent by Earth herself, would be called stupid or insane. But in this one special case, believing in the unlikely is actually a positive attribute, something which they call faith. Earth is, as usual, unwilling to weigh in on the conversation herself, which they appreciate as a tacit approval of what they are saying, conveniently. Wisely, however, you avoid making any declarations of falsehood outright. Instead, you engage in respectful conversation. You guide the beast's thoughts to one thing and then another, and in the end, it all comes down to the call of the leaf you hold in your claws. Bloom counters cleverly. Each animal says that it is a different leafy color, and if any of them are correct, you must accept that Bloom was correct, by the logic that they all speak for Bloom. They're shocked when you open your forepaw and show that it was not any kind of leaf at all, but a small gray stone. It seems that Bloom could not even tell what was right in front of it. Bloom's disciples do not know what to make of it. Their fervor to face it, battle is lessened. Bloom is deeply insulted by this and steps forward, shoving it past its followers to face it personally. Its owner at stake, the dance of destruction begins at two of you. The dance of destruction begins. Our exultant leader paws and gathers all of its power, prepared to reduce its foe to ash. So it's gonna use a fire attack. It's kind of a dead giveaway, this rooster. Anyway, we're gonna go, I think we can take her on, him on, her on, not sure. How do you gender a giant lizard? Let's go pacify. Like a mighty river to the great one flowed, turning the enemy's rage back on itself. Like a mighty river, huh? I guess it's hinting that they'll use a water attack next. Let's go blow it away. Sweat strike! No match. Bloom has been defeated and driven away. Victory is yours once more, as is another feather token of your power. As it passes out of your territory, you hear Bloom's herald announce, "Rejoice, believers in the perfect one! Our Hierophant and Overlord reveals that this was not the promised land, but merely a test of our loyalty, which we have passed. Rejoice!" Most good beasts, however, are quite aware of the truth. You have crushed yet another invader, and the spirit wood, Heart of the Great Green, remains yours and yours alone. Elegant plume. This is a colorful and elegant feather for the crown of Bloom, the beast-shielded invader whom you bested. And we got improved reputation. We should actually talk to the neighbors. But first we have to gather some treasures. Casting about the shore of one of your eponymous twin lakes, you discover an interesting potential source of treasure. Though it gleams like the rarest shinestone, it is not, nor is it a gem. It is amber, made out of the essence of trees and refined by time. Water has cleansed and polished it into perfection. There is, however, an issue. The majority of it is trapped beneath quite a few large stones. Moving them will be no challenge for an elder, but unfortunately, thousands of turnings stand between you and that vaunted title. Will you put your strength to the test? Yes. You may not be an elder, but for a young kid, you are mighty indeed. It takes quite a bit of time, but you push it and lift the stones one by one until they reveal the fugitive amber. Bringing it back to your lair requires two trips and takes the rest of the sun, but you and your gaze upon them later, you feel not only of the joy of possession, but also the pride of strength well proven. Nice! Much shine-filled treasure. Ooh. It is a hunting moon, and as you bathe in the moonlight outside of your lair and look over your domain, a many-voiced song rises up from the depths of the great green. The clan singers are singing a song of summoning. We call upon the long-necked lord, the firebringer, remnant of before time. If you know order, come to us, the spirit claw clan summons you. You find all of the warriors of the clan waiting for you on a hill at the edge of their territory, facing your lair. As you approach, their giver chief and their birther chief rise. The giver chief speaks first. I am Splits a Knight, who rends the night, who rends the darkness with a clear voice, creator of many and first unto danger. This night it is given to me to sing of our grievances with you. But no! But you have not transgressed, no, not once. Never have you earned our condemnation, never have you shown weakness nor dishonor. My song of blame has no fangs. The murder chief then comes to the fore. I am Fragrant Spirit, whose essence is pleasing to the Green One, creator of many and source of life. This night it is given to me to sing on your behalf, to count your virtues. You have dealt fairly with our seedling, the bold dispersed you allowed to pass and carry our essence to places unknown. Our song and future are strengthened. You have shown strength greater even than the rumors of the kin. You have bested us in a fair challenge, honorably winning renown in a bounty of flesh. Great and wonderful is your mystery, for you have spared our future. Our cubs are safe in their den, though you had the power in a moment to destroy them. Though we understand it not, we give thanks for your mercy, for the shadow of love we find in you. We perceive that you are not an enemy, but we understand not your ancient mind. Our confusion disturbs us. Why have you shown love and honor to a people not your own? Say that you have come to love their people, their clan, more than other good beasts. This sends the clan singers into confusion. Can love so holy of them extend between beasts of different kinds? After some discussion, they ask what you wish of them. Say that you wish to become their chief, your lands shall become theirs, and your wisdom and protection shall be upon them always. You speak of your deep understanding of their way, how your very essence resonates with their music. You sing of their honor and bravery in their wild strength and beautiful song. But most of all, you speak of the love which binds them together and how that same love has now crossed a new boundaries and bound your essence to theirs. You are meant to find them and become their chief, to make yourself a pathway for them to achieve new heights of goodness and power. Into your song, you weave the knowledge you have gained of their people, and they are awestruck. It is as though your sigils are imprinted not only to their minds, but onto their very souls. In the end, their giver chief and the birther chief step forward. Nothing else needs to be sung. They have acknowledged your challenge for the allegiance of their people, and now you must prove your strength according to their tradition. Okay, so we're gonna go... Bite! Okay, so, he is injured. Water or air is the next plan, the next possible attack, so we're gonna go bite again. Not that I needed to do anything. The chief surrenders, baring its throat and belly to you. Having defeated a standing chief in open combat, the clan acknowledges you as worthy to lead them. If you are mighty enough, you can challenge the other to a fight if you wish. Defeating both their giver chief and birther chief at once will truly be a tale retold through many generations. Challenge the other chief as well. There's a key word there, through many generations. That will be important later. Okay, so let's see. Let's go, bite. Ah! Okay, that's water. Next one will be fire, so let's go, flowing strike. Knockout! As you accept the honorable surrender of the other chief, the clan dances and sings around you. It is the will of the green! Praise our all-powerful great chief! And we got improved reputation. Oh, that's beautiful. Over the next few suns, the Spirit Claw clan migrates to its new home, your lair. Spirit Claw clan, these are the warriors of the green, good beasts which have been blessed by the spirit of the green to meet its talons. Accordingly, they are called the Ghost Claw, or spirits, or claws of the Spirit clan. They now recognize you as their great chief, and their keen senses are yours to command. The acceptance of Andrea as their leader is unprecedented, but the connection you have forged with these noble good beasts is powerful and true. When the hunting moon rises over the great green, a new song may be heard. The clan singer's chorus now features a new voice, yours. Goobies far and wide come into the spectacle. Some even join into your lands to hear this wonderful dissonance, harmonious in its diversity. Now from your own lair, clan singer voices ring out. We are the people of the far-telling song who sing with one voice, which is many voices. To be alone is weakness, to be together is strength. Praise be to the great green, shard of the mother's being, pouring out sweetness in the crystal pure waters and the ruby-sweet essence of our honorable prey. Praise be to our prey, whose flesh becomes ours, givers of life, the dance partners eternal. We remember with song your great sacrifice. Praise be to those who came before, our ancestors who learned to bridge love and violence across being one and being many and not be split in twain. And for the first time a new verse is added. Praise be to our great chief, many call it kin to the ancient ones, who bridges what was and what shall be, who burns a new path for us with strength and honor and fire. Praise be to Earth, great mother of us all, for we love her and are one in her. Hear now our song of joy. We live! We live! We live! Oh man, I remember how emotional I was when I first saw this, which you will see at some point. And now we got an achievement. The Moon. Only with many voices can one discover true harmony. This grants a substantial bonus to air. And we got improved reputation. Now we got puppies. 7th grade mastery in the air element. You can now hypnotize their enemies, forcing them to choose an element in battle. Okay, so let us see. There's our there's the prismatic thing. A new sun has risen, your song of life continues. A new truth has leaked from the pyramid and slithered golden into your dreams, teaching you of the secrets of Earth. So basically, it will slowly top off the Earth mastery, or mastery of the weakest element you have, until you level up. Kind of a bummer we didn't get it before we faced off Bloom, because there's a really funny interaction with Bloom. You will see at some point. But for now, I think it is time to meet the neighbors. How many shiny stuff do we have? 36. The Empire of Reeds. In the minds of the good beasts of the Great Green, that is a name given to this place. Grass can dominate the land for suns, joining you warm winsome here. Hardstone becomes rare, replaced by a soft reality of water, sweet muck, and life in tremendous variety and volume. Stately spirit bills wade between tiny islands. Waterbound creatures swarm in the shallows, and hard shell claw snaps ply them out with larger creatures of many kinds. Visit the greys, drink, bathe, and hunt. Of course, this lush territory will not be without a Drake to claim it. You stand now on the boundary, scent marked by the kin whose home this is. What will you do? Let us announce our presence as tradition demands. You sing a song of annunciation, the mighty rush of air from your voice startles nearby enemies, sending them skyward. Soon afterward, a kin appears, one of the Sapphire Clan, who have power wherever water rules. It is capable of flight, judging by the size of its wings, but still young for an adult, perhaps only 100 turnings old. His mind song is fluid and graceful, starting with small shapes and then extending images and emotions outward in all directions. I am the slow-headed current which builds the crushing wave. I am the patient breeze which rises to a tempest. I am the Reed Lord. How will you address the tempest? The Reed Lord. Oh, come on. Not now. Why is something caught in my throat? How will you address Tempest, the Reed Lord? Introduce yourself and say that you have come to acknowledge Tempest territory, asking in return that it acknowledges yours. Tempest listens to your introduction patiently and, after briefly considering, answers. So shall it be. I have little interest in the cold war and dry skin, and furthermore, that land is overblessed. The spirit of the Great Green lives close by. Claim it as territory as you have is perilous and presumptuous. Here, where the water and life are plentiful, is the home of my choosing. Remain far from my empire, and I shall mirror your inaction. As if Tempest knows Darktooth. Darktooth is an elder of my clan who leaves the wise end from here. It is a mostly barren land, infested with the tailless. Once it was the overlord of many tides, but it abandoned the cool waters for a dry wasteland. It is one of the seven great elders, the Paragons. I cannot claim to understand its purposes. Its wisdom is far famed, and its songs carry the weight of mountains, though some of its recent actions seem strange. How's about the Sapphire Clan? While your Emerald Clan became an abbot of the Great Green, my clan made a pact with the Great Blue. We gave ourselves over to water, its rhythm, and its music. Our bodies flow freely through it, and we can hold air within ourselves longer than any other clan, allowing us to dance in the dark depths which sun has never seen. Fire holds little sway in the water realm. We bartered away our flame breath for a new kind of fire, the sparking glances which spread, shock, stun, and kill. Still, we have far more in common than otherwise. We are kin as you are, true children of above and below, greatest of all the beasts, save for sun and earth themselves. We seek treasure and prey and dominion. We are true kin. Let us challenge Tempest for a prize of treasure. Tempest tail rises and falls in a gesture of mirth which sends water splashing. Very well, child, for 10 shiny things I will wager as an artifact which no longer interests me. Will you truly engage me in the riddle challenge? Yes. Here's my riddle. I am the herald of he who is the greatest. I break but never shatter. And the answer to that is Dawn. Which I know from a previous playthrough. Because dawn breaks, and he announces the sun's rising. There's a bit of micro stuttering for some reason, as if the game is slightly lagging. Tempest crest rises, inner eyelids sliding upwards. It is clearly surprised. This youngling has a promising mind. I will not underestimate you again. Take your prize. You sense in that saying in the Emperor Freeze any longer will not be wise and return to your lair. Though you may not be great enough to challenge Tempest for its territory, you are able at least to obtain an artifact. You obtain a bizarre. Tempest of Reed Lord surrounded this to you. It is obviously a stone, and yet it smells like flesh. Puppies. Yeah, that Earth Mastery is almost full, which is nice. Let's just go meet Warden next. He's like eating the oxus over there. Following the shallow river, which runs through the Spirit Wood to the Great Blue, you come across a clearly and frequently marked scent boundary. One of the kin claims this green and its pleasant land as its territory, known as the Riverwood for its harmonious combination of plants and fresh, clean water. Plants of every kind are abundant here, and bees as well. Hunting here would probably be very easy, but to hunt in another kin's territory without first announcing oneself would be a breach of custom. What will you do? Let us sing a song of annunciation, and let's not anger anybody. Your song has barely echoed through the trees when a young adult kin appears. It is one of your old emerald clan, and a rather stunning specimen. I am the arranger of the proper order, my correctness shines on the maiden. It pauses briefly to smooth out its chest feathers, making certain none are out of place, and impedes its crest before you. Before continuing, I am the putter of things in blaze, the one who remembers forgotten distances. I am the lord and keeper of the riverwood, preserver of the perfect immensity. Demesni. I've been mispronouncing that for like all of the previous playthroughs. Interesting. This kin seems rather proud of its custodianship of the region. In your mind, you name it Warden. It picks through the feathers on its right wing, examining them as it waits for you to state your business. What will you do? You have 36 shiny objects. Compliment Warden on its appearance. Warden preens itself as it listens to your praise. This body is indeed superior, but still maddeningly imperfect. This talon is slightly shorter than its mate, and my other forepaw, the color of this feather in my breast is up by a fraction of a shade for what it should be, and that is not all. Still, I move toward perfection. My flaws are fewer than they were. Eventually, I shall attain it. Acknowledge Warden's territory, and as it all known as yours. Before I respond, answer, what defines beauty? And order. Warden thumps its tail, a sensible response. Obviously, the stars in the night sky, some are bright and some are dim, but they all have their place. Their dance is so perfect that it has become fixed, a moving stasis. We too could be like they, immutable, immortal. The order which can be observed in the heavens must be reproduced upon earth, such is the meaning of the ancient song, as above, so below. I have endeavored to make my demesne a monument to order without even a leaf nor stone out of place. It has not been easy, and chaos constantly menaces, but one day I shall have the perfect territory. You have gained some air mastery. Now sing on my way. Is it not good? Is it not just? I have sacrificed many suns, even moons, and turnings to the main pursuit of perfection. Can you deny its result? Is my territory not the most beautiful? I'm gonna disagree on moral grounds. Warden's idea of perfection may not coincide with that of any other beings. And by forcing his land and creatures to act as it wishes, Warden violates the Great Way. Warden's head bobs, bringing up the fire seed. It sees that they have greatly angered it. How dare you question my understanding? I have seen many turnings, and nature has just rewarded you of the most perfect territory in existence. The plants and beasts of the land are slow-witted and in need of a greater intelligence to guide them. I do this out of moral obligation, not moral failing. You invalidate my sacred way when you are worrying over the experiences of others. If you will not acknowledge my way as good, then neither I shall acknowledge yours. Your hunting grounds are not safe for me. Be warned. Though you have displeased Warden by speaking your truth against his bizarre way, your other kin may be impressed at your courage and rectitude. And we get a compassion stat. What will you do? Compassion stat? Okay, I did not actually get the compassion stat on my Dragon Thoughts system. Anyway. Ask Warden about the no-tales you have heard that some dwell near Warden's land. Those filthy degenerate responds, it hulf, lashing its tail back and forth. They creep about the periphery of my lands and disturb my order. I have made certain that none who enter my territory live alive. They do not belong here, and as long as they remain, order is threatened. Their pollution, their chaos is inextricable from their natures. In the end, however, they are nothing but honest and are easily destroyed. Such pitiful, weak, twisted things are not worth another moment of our consideration. We defile our songs merely by thinking about those disgusting droppings and the defilers of long ago. What will you do? Wager 10 shiny things and challenge Warden for a piece of its treasure. Warden tilts his head slightly, pondering this. I have long admired number, absolute, inarguable, concrete number. For many turnings I have played with number in the guard of my mind. It soothes and consoles me when I am dismayed by chaos. With number, all is either correct or not correct as it should be, with no space for disagreement. Therefore, my challenge to you is a challenge of number. I shall present you with a problem. Prepare yourself for once I present it, you will have about a short time to answer. Here's my question to you. I'm instinctively looking for my calculator already. Go, sharp EL520X. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna try to solve it legitimately without using a calculator first. Subtract 7 from 10, that will be 3. Add 6, that will be 9. 9 times 7, I'm gonna calculate that. 9 times 7, 63. Subtract 7 from 10, that is 3. 3 plus 6 is 9. 9 times 7, 9 times 7 is gonna be 63. And subtract 11, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11. 52. Despite having lost, Warden looks happy, thumbing its tail as it offers you a small artifact of some kind. Well answered, I have hope for a future, knowing that youth among the kin can move gracefully within the sacred crystal realm of number. Okay, I had to calculate that, but multiplication is not my strong suit. Heavy cube! The most interesting aspect of this giant stone object which I will take for more than is that it's much heavier than anyone would think possible for them so small. Could wondrous power be inside? Warden turns away from you by its way dismissal. I encourage you to embrace order and perfection. They alone shall lead the way to the future of the kin. Unless you are bold or foolish enough to challenge me for my territory, I wish you well. As you leave, you know that Warden's territory is indeed very beautiful in a way, but it is so rigid, so intentional as to be almost disquieting. You wonder if the spirit of Great Green truly wants such a thing as perfection. Here we got fifth grade mastery in the earth element. We now have self-control to resist pain, and we have half the penalty for injury, which is good. That is sorely needed. And again, the pyramid's like buffing us up constantly, which is nice. Ooh. There's one more thing you can do with the minisks after getting the pyramid. You believe your business with the minisks concluded, but as you pass by their settlement on the latter sun, its lights flash as though to gain your attention. Curious, you turn aside. The minisks have, it seems, been experiencing great difficulty on account of a simple innocent foe, water. The falling rain has been flooding their shining transport lines, and the constant humidity is slowing their progress as they labor towards the completion of their mission. They ask your permission to move their entire colony into your dry and stone sheltered cave. They have no immediate reward to offer you, but they believe your mind is advanced enough to appreciate the concept of generosity. They have to explain that the concept to you several times, and eventually you do understand it, though you still doubt its value. Having their hive in your lair will beautify it, but these beings are strange and other, and not knowing their true purpose, you know not what weal or woe they may bring. What do you do? Accede to their request. I guess it means accept. Accede to their request. The minis receive your decision with joy. Shortly thereafter, you discover that their entire demesne has been rebuilt in your lair near a trove. Crystal City! This is a crystal hive built by the tiny intelligent beings which once dwelt in the stump in the deeps of the Great Green. It is flawless and self-complete. Thank you for watching my premiere. Don't I just look so fabulous and amazing? Well, I'm gonna be honest here. I'm kinda sorry for like my inconsistent premiere schedules, but I'm having troubles finding the time to edit things together. Oof. Anyway, this part, there's not much to say about it. Most of us have been seen it before, but I think this is a lot more of an optimized run, isn't it? But also, what else can I say, right? I'm just trying to breeze past part 2 as much as possible so we can get to part 3 in the fabulous new DLC content that we've all been waiting for. So yeah, excuse my delay. I'm just like, well, just like overloaded because so much stuff happening in real life and also online. You know, gotta do what we can, right? But anyway, if you watch all the way to the end, you know what to do, and I will see you guys later. Hopefully in a much more better condition than this. But for now, you know, thank you. I'll see you guys later. Goodbye.